In this video, we will discuss how to calculate the bandgap energy from photoluminescence excitation and emission data using origin. These calculations will be compared with the bandgap value obtained from UV-Vis data. PL data is obtained from a fluorescence spectrometer in the form of excitation and emission spectra. The excitation spectrum is obtained by scanning a sample at a predefined wavelength range, while the emission spectrum is obtained by exciting a sample at a higher energy and observing the resulting emission at lower energies. Before proceeding further in the tutorial, let us first explain the phenomenon of photoluminescence and the terminologies associated with it. When the light of sufficient energy, more than the bandgap energy, excites a semiconductor or a dielectric material, and as a result of relaxation, the material is illuminated, is called photoluminescence. If the illumination time is short, it is called fluorescence, while the non-illumination time is called phosphorescence. During the relaxation, if only photons are emitted, the bandgap is termed as a direct bandgap. If phonons are also emitted with the photons, the material will heat up as a result, and the bandgap is termed as an indirect bandgap. Now, let us learn how to convert the incident energy values into some feasible units. As E is equal to h nu and nu is equal to C over lambda, put the values in this equation. As we will find the bandgap energy in electron volt, so we will convert joule to electron volt by this relation. Putting lambda in nanometer instead of meter, we can have its simplification as this. Since our experimental data, lambda is in nanometer. This finally gives E equal to 1240 by lambda. Before proceeding towards the calculations, let us first understand the photoluminescence process. We know that the photoexcitation promotes electron from the valence band to the conduction band by leaving a hole in the valence band. The electron in the conduction band relaxes quickly within 15 to 25 picoseconds, radiatively or non-radiatively. In radiative relaxation, an electron emits a photon, while in a non-radiative relaxation, phonons are emitted whose combined energy is equal to the energy of the photon. The emission of phonons is a result of defects, impurities, and dopants between the conduction and valence bands. In non-radiative relaxation, there are two types of recombinations. When an electron passes its energy to the phonons, it is called Shockley-Redhand recombination. When a relaxing electron passes its energy to another electron or hole, it is called OJ recombination. Only in radiative recombination, emitted photon energy is equal to the bandgap energy. From PL data, intensity, line edge and FWHM are the characteristics parameters from which we can extract information about a sample. For example, higher intensity means low defect density, broader FWHM indicates a poor structure, and vice versa. All such informations we will extract in the forthcoming videos. In addition to the calculations from PL data, let me mention some limitations during the bandgap calculations from PL data. Number first, Only direct bandgap materials can be studied for energy bandgap calculation. As indirect bandgap materials do not possess luminescence but thermally lose their energy in the form of phonons instead of photons. PL emissions do not give an exact bandgap as the emissions are not 100% radiative in nature. There is always an associated portion of non-radiative emissions. Therefore, it is better to calculate it from the absorbance data, that is UV-Vis data. Due to this reason, the bandgap calculated by the PL study will always be less than the original bandgap. Emission spectra are usually solvent dependent and are shifted with the change in solvent polarity due to solvent relaxation. That is why the excitation spectra are usually preferred for bandgap calculations than emission spectra. Now let us start with the calculations in origin. This is the hexathiobenzene. Here we have the UV-Vis data from which we can calculate the bandgap energy in order to compare it with the PL data calculations. First, let us open the UV-Vis data. This is the data with some calculations for the bandgap energy which we have already discussed in the above appearing video link. Plot the absorption data first. Now plot the indirect bandgap first and then the direct bandgap. We can see that the linearity of the direct bandgap is more, so we will consider it. Let us extend the linear region onto the x-axis to get value of the bandgap. The value of the bandgap comes out to be 2.8 electron volt. Now, let us open the PL data. This is the PL excitation and this is the PL emission data. Plot the data individually for the excitation and emission. In the excitation spectrum, the first peak gives the band edge value. However, we will not extrapolate it like the UV-Vis data as the PL mechanism is somehow different from the UV absorption. We will consider the maximum value in the first peak. This value comes out to be 412 nanometer. To get the value of bandgap energy in electron volt, we will convert this value by using the relation 1240 by lambda, which we have already discussed in the above mentioned video. Thus, the value comes out to be 3 electron volt. Now, calculate the same value from the emission data. Here in the emission data, we again use the maximum of the first prominent peak. This comes out to be 467.5 nanometer. Again, we will convert this value into the electron volt by using the above mentioned relation. Thus, the bandgap value in the emission spectrum comes out to be 2.6 electron volt. If we compare these bandgap values with the bandgap value from the UV-Vis data, the excitation spectrum value is slightly over, while the emission spectrum value is slightly less than the UV-Vis absorption value. It is to be noted that the bandgap value from the PL data critically varies from sample to sample. For some samples, excitation spectrum data proves to be more accurate, while for some, the emission spectrum data. This is due to the fact that PL spectra depend on the status of the sample, like defects, impurities, dopants, and the contribution of the non-radiative energy transfer to the actual energy, radiative energy, that is measured by the device. Thanks for watching the video and stay tuned for the forthcoming videos.